thanks for joining us this morning early. As we've told quite a few of you, Dirk's got a very tight schedule while he's in town before he heads up to the hall. So we'll need to put up a hard cap on this at some point, probably around 10 o'clock. But Dirk is here to meet with you guys until then. So we'll open with statements. And then Alan and Mike have roving microphones. Or Alan and Dave have roving microphones. And so if you want to wait on one of those, that'd be great, because we are streaming this. So, again, appreciate it.
Big time. Well, thank you. I'll keep this brief, my statement. I'm sure you guys have plenty of questions. Thanks for coming this morning. This is a big week. I can't believe it's actually here. You know, you hear so much about whatever people say, your first ballot, and you go in the Hall of Fame, and you're kind of just shrugging it off as a great compliment, and now we're actually here. It feels super surreal. And I'm excited, but also, of course, a little anxious and nervous for this weekend. We just got back from our travels last weekend. It's a couple busy days, and I'm already going up to the hall tomorrow. We've got some stuff already coming up Thursday, so can't wait to go. And it'll be an exciting weekend with plenty of friends and family flying in from all over the world. So I'm looking forward to a great, great time. So. Thank you guys for coming this morning.
In PriceMaps.com, Dirk, have you allowed yourself to think ahead to that day when they're going to put the jacket on your shoulders, your back, and what that moment would be like?
Yeah, I mean, it's like I said, I just cannot believe that. First of all, it's 4 years already. I'm out of the league, and now the time is already. Has already come that I'm going in, and I think the whole weekend will be sort of surreal. And I think, you know, at some point, you know, I always got to kind of stop. I know there's the itinerary is packed every minute probably, and I just got to make sure sometimes I stop and reflect a little bit and really still enjoy what's going on. Even, you know, obviously when the speech on Saturday, I want to get up there, but still enjoy and not be too nervous that I really can't enjoy it at the magnitude of this moment. So it's going to be fun. So we're getting the jackets, obviously Friday night in the ring, and then the induction ceremony is then Saturday night. So I mean the whole thing will be unbelievable. Going in with an incredible class, with people obviously that I've known and competed against for a long, long time. So I'm looking forward to it.
Tell us what that fitting process was for your jacket, because I understand a Dallas company made the Hall of Fame jacket.
Yes, they did. So we did all that in Houston during the Final Four when we first got announced, and we got invited, and we got to go to the semifinals game, and it was a super cool moment. We all got to walk in this room, and there were all these stations. You get fitted for your ring and your jacket, and when I went up to get my jacket, they're like, "Mav's in the house." Like, what are you talking about? And you're like, we're from Dallas, we're a Dallas company. And so it was a cool moment. And, you know, I got my, going to have my Mavs logos in my jacket. So I can't wait to see it.
Hey, Dirk, Jason Winnick of Dallas Sports Source. Back in June of 1998, you were acquired by the Mavericks along with Steve Nash. You end up landing in Dallas in an area in a city that you like probably felt like you were landing in the land of Oz. What was it like making the adjustment, coming to America, experiencing the culture shock, and adapting to America and being able to launch your career?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've said it a lot of times that it was hard for me back then. In a way, the last 20 something years, the world's gone a lot smaller with internet, with social media, but back then you just couldn't hop on Google and see what it's like in Texas. So I had no idea really what to expect, and it was a hard time. First, there was a little bit of a language barrier, and then, of course, there was the lockout year that came on top of it, and then the game was so different. So I had a hard time adjusting my first season, and you know, the language barrier was tough. That it was so tough that at times I didn't really want to say anything. I just was super quiet and was just trying to learn as much as I could on the fly. And I'll always remember this one time I didn't practice my first year. I think I was banged up, and we had Hot Rod Williams at the time, and he sat next to me. And the entire hour and a half, he talked to me and tried to teach me something. I didn't understand a word he said because of his Louisiana accent. And so that kind of sums up, I think, my first year here. I was just trying to learn stuff and on the fly, on the go, within like 5-6 games a week. And I mean, it was a tough time. But once I came back, then that summer was big for me. I played summer league, I played international ball, I played the 99 European championships. And then I came back for a full season. I had my apartment lined up at that point then. I got a car, and just everything was coming together smoothly off the court. And then I was able to also feel a lot better on the court.
Dirk, Joe Trahan from WFAA TV. Hey, Dirk. First of all, I want to say thanks for bringing that championship. And I've been here for 20 years, man. That's the only one we've gotten in the Big Four. So thank you, first of all. I'm curious, when you went back and were preparing for your speech, what that process was like, and was there one memory in particular that flooded back when you were working on that speech? I mean, I know the championship's obvious, but a particular memory about something that flowed back to you?
You know, I've been working basically off and on the speech for the last couple months, ever since, of course, I heard that I'm going in. And it's kind of like you at the beginning, you kind of sit down and you write some people down that you don't want to forget. And then you write down some memories. And then you kind of left it alone for a few weeks, and we traveled a lot. And then I kind of came back to it again and maybe wrote some other thoughts down. But at the end of the day, it's just another thank you speech. You know, to me, I'm so thankful to all these people that have helped me along the way. And so that's what I will look at it. I'm not going to tell that many stories. It's more to me about at the biggest stage, giving thanks to all the people that were involved in my career. And what was funny to reflect on was really a little bit of my childhood. You know, when I speak to my parents and my sister, obviously, I think I will get a little emotional. Stuff that they've done and put their lives on hold at the time, and drove me from one event, from tennis to handball to basketball. And so that what they've done, and obviously Holger meeting him at age 15, and some of the workouts we were doing. I think those were besides the championship and of course the big moments. Those were some of the coolest reflections.
Hey, Dirk, Pat Doney with NBC5 here in Dallas. As you reflect, talking about reflecting now, with the positionless NBA that we're living in now, that was brand new when you were doing that. It seemed the big man shooting and all of that. Can you just speak to how challenging that was, being different in that way at that time? And your sense of pride now when you look around the NBA and you see big men shooting threes all the time now in today's game?
Yeah, I think the game has evolved so much since I first got in the league. You know, in the 90s, it was still a physical league. The fours and fives were all bangers and rebounders. There's a few outliers, but most of all, there was the fours and fives of big guys and defenders and rebounders. And I was sort of came in at the right time, I think, when the league was just changing. The NBA was a little tired of, you know, the 70 to 80 score and Knicks-Miami physical series, a lot of holding, pushing. And so I think they wanted to get away from some of the physical play. They got rid of the hand check and all that. Obviously, saying all that, that sort of played right into my hands. I was a guy that loved to face up, be outside, play with more on the perimeter than banging with the big guys. And then, of course, I think Nelly helped, of course. I think if I would have gone to another team, maybe they would have bulked me up, maybe would have stuck me under the basket for to play closer to the basket. But Nelly was, he just saw the game different, always has. He was a mismatch master. And he wanted me to shoot. He encouraged me to play my style. I always say that there weren't a lot of coaches at the time that wanted a 7-footer dribbling the ball up at times and shooting pull-up threes. But that was his style. And so I do owe him a lot at of how the whole thing started off. So he was huge for me. And so those were the good old days. The sort of the game was changing and there were more of a passing game, shooting skill set over physicality. And that sort of played in my hands, and certainly then in all the European bigs that then came along, and then Powell, of course, was going in with, now with me. You know, that style, that complete more passing game, and lots of pick and rolls is where the league went, and that's sort of what we grew up with. So that kind of fit right into our style.
The Basketball Hall of Fame is not just the NBA, but basketball all across the world. Have you thought back to some of your times with the German national team? Can you explain what that meant to you, being able to play for them, and any memories that you can remember?
Yeah, you know, my two biggest dreams were always winning the NBA championship and playing the Olympic Games one time. And so I got to, of course, achieve both of these dreams. Was a great ride also with international basketball. I represented Germany ever since I can remember. I mean, I was playing junior national team at age 14, 15. We're traveling through Europe, playing, you know, other countries where some of my classmates had never left my hometown. So I'm very thankful to the German Basketball Federation and the ride that I've been on with them. And we've had some great success. I've been able to travel the world and then, you know, carry the flag in the Beijing 2008 Olympics, which is still one of the best moments of my career, and I'll never forget for the rest of my life. So it's been also an incredible ride with the German team and with the teammates, and some of the Federation guys are still the same from when I played or when I started. And so it's been a great ride as well, and I can't thank those guys enough.
Hey, Dirk, Mike Ducey, Fox 4, congratulations. How much does it mean to you to go into the Hall of Fame having played for just one franchise in the NBA? And was there a time where you thought you might end up with another franchise?
You know, it means, of course, a lot to me that it worked out that way. But, of course, I had no idea that it was going to play out like this at the beginning. I mean, when I got here, I had no idea. I wasn't even sure whether I'd stay my whole rookie season the way, my whole rookie contract, the way things were going in year one. I was struggling a bit. I think it's normal to have some doubts. Hey, should I go back to Europe or should I have done this and that? And then, you know, Mark just buying the team my second year and he being my number one supporter. And then, of course, us getting better and the city getting more and more excited about the Mavs basketball, you know, because the 90s, as we all know, were a tough decade for the Mavs fans, and so their early 2000s, that was, I always said it was some of the best times. So when we changed the reputation around here of Mavs basketball again, and put with Mark behind the team, and created that hype, and you know, build a new arena, and so. Those were some of the most fun years I've had playing for the Mavericks, when Steve, Mike, and I, of course, were getting better. And then, you know, that was just a great time. All of a sudden, people were starting to recognize us around town, where my rookie year, we'd go in a bar and have a burger afterwards, and nobody knew who we were. And then, you know, just it was a fun transition there for us. And so... saying all that, of course, I wanted to finish my career here and make it work. But then, of course, there was disappointments. But I still always said, hey, I want to make this work. I would love to bring a championship to the city, a basketball championship that's never been achieved here in the city. And so, you know, I really wasn't a free agent until 2010, before I obviously signed a big franchise deal for 6 years. And so in 2010, I met with Mark, and I mean, really had no other offers. I never really listened around, but that meeting I will never forget. I went to Mark's house, I mean, and we just sat there and both shared emotions, shared stories from the past, whatever, 11 years, what it's been, and we both got emotional, and I basically told him, listen, I want to be here. You want me to be here. Let's get this done. And then I ended up, of course, staying, and then we won the championship in year one of that 4-year contract. So that was also a special time. And once we had won the championship, I knew I was going to retire here. That would have been the only reason at the end of my career to go somewhere to maybe chase a ring or win one somewhere else. But since we had achieved that goal, I knew I wanted to retire here.
Hey, Dirk, congrats on the Hall of Fame. You kind of talk a little bit about how the early parts of your career were pretty rough for you, and now fast forward 20-something years, and you know there's been so much outward appreciation, not only for what you've meant to the city of Dallas, but also to the game of basketball. Like, the last 4 years since you retired, has it at all sunk into you, like, how much you've meant to so many people, or is it still kind of surreal?
It's still a little surreal. But it's still amazing. I mean, especially when I was fresh out and I just had retired and when I moved around the city, how many people came up to me and said, you know, they appreciated me for what I've done and might have gotten them through some tough times in their lives. And just by playing a simple sport that, of course, meant a lot to me. And now I'm still traveling the world and people approach me all the time or like, appreciate what you've done and played your heart out for 2 decades, and that of course means a lot. But you know, the smaller kids don't recognize me anymore now. So I'm already out for 5 years. There's other guys that are hotter, but usually the parents still recognize me. But the young kids, you're like, who's big guy? And then the parents are like, don't you know that's Dirk Nowitzki? I'm like, no, I don't. It's been incredible feedback all over the world, and it's enjoying it a lot.
Hey, Dirk, it's Jessica Armstrong, Valley Sports. Hi, congrats. But I have a question. We talk about the big moments, the championship, the 30,000 points, 50-point games. When you look back at your career, any memorable moments for you that weren't the big milestones, any games that like stick out of your performances that may not have been the flashiest ones that you're like, I played a damn good game?
I mean, yeah, there were really too many to remember. I think some of the playoff runs were the most fun. I always say that it's to have a long playoff run is super tough. You know, you don't sleep much. The pressure is always on. You want to always keep the momentum. You want to always win. If you lose, you can't sleep. But that's also why we play, and that's what it's all about. So some of these amazing long runs, even though at the end we didn't win it all, were some of the best times in those playoffs. Every day you come in, you prepare, you change a little bit of the game plan, you go out the next night against the same team, and you go at it. And that's some of the best time when the best players shine. And I really enjoyed playoff time. And so we were able and lucky to, obviously we had a stretch there. I think we made it 10 years straight. And those were some of the most fun memories. But there's not really one game. Obviously, if I think about it, when I had my career high here at home against Houston, which was an incredible game with T-Mac being hot. And there's little games along the way that obviously were super cool and super fun to be a part of. But I mean, how many games did I play? 1,500 or something insane. I mean, it's too many to remember.
Dirk, I think when we were talking last week, you said your kids are 10, 8, and 6, and they've been through to the various ceremonies. I think it was Max who helped push the button. Wondered if there was any funny or interesting stories or things they've said after or during one of these ceremonies or driving past your statue or on your street or anything like that?
Yeah, I think the whole thing is still surreal for them too. I don't think they really understand what I've really done. They always say, you know, they always watch me towards the end of my career and all they know is, Papa, you were so slow. Then I gotta go to YouTube and it's all grainy still, the films, but I try to pull up some stuff from the early 2000s, but they're not really having it. But yeah, I mean they're still young. I think my daughter understands the most. She's 10 now, and I think she's mostly embarrassed about the whole hoopla or when people recognize me when we travel, and she goes, "Oh God!" and she just walks the other way. She's a shy kid that just doesn't like all when we get all the attention and as a family. And So she understands most. I'm not really sure they understand this Hall of Fame weekend. I mean, they keep saying we're going to Massachusetts, right? But they don't really understand what it means, I guess, especially the boys. But, you know, 10, 20 years down the line, it'd be so cool to go there again and see my space or whatever and see my name there. That's something, of course, I look forward to. Maybe grandkids at some point, when it gets to that point, and take them there. I mean, that'll be a super emotional but also proud moment when it gets to that spot.
Derek, Landon with LandonBuford.com. I was with Jamal Crawford last week and then also Detlef Schrempf as well. I know you have history with both of those. Jamal said your final game at home was a movie. Obviously, he had to go get his phone to, you know, for the ceremony, and Detlef was in the building as well. Just your thoughts about just favorite first facing Detlef for the first time in Seattle and then also that final game against Jamal Crawford.
Yeah, my first game was a crazy memory. Probably one of the worst games I played as an NBA player. Just the magnitude of the moment, it was just overwhelming at all. You know, I'm changing in the locker room all of a sudden. You know, Steiny's standing right there looking at me. I'm like, what are these people doing here in the locker room? Like, this is the players getting ready. It's just everything was so different that the whole pregame warm-up as I knew it was completely different. And then you know, meeting Detlef before the game, we took a picture at the jump circle, and I mean, I was like, the whole thing was a movie myself, and it was really hard to kind of just focus on basketball. I was so nervous and anxious, and but also a great memory. But that was my first game. It was probably one of the worst games that I played. And in my last game, of course, last home game, I will never forget. I'll never forget what the Mavericks did for me. You know, flying in my heroes as a surprise, then us winning the game. Jamal going off was—I got a lot of respect for him. How he handled himself, how he's the player he is and was. So that was just a super fun atmosphere all night. Every time I touched the ball, I felt like there was—I felt the excitement. And so, and then of course the ceremony after, and so that's a game that I will never forget for the rest of my life.
Hey, Dirk, Landon Thomas, Mavs Fans for Life. You have two presenters, Steve Nash, Jason Kidd. Just walk us through the process of choosing two instead of one, and how do those players, how much they meant to you?
So I actually wanted three. I wanted Nelly to be there as well. Fortunately, he can't make it. And so that was that left me with two Hall of Famers. Obviously, the presenters have to be Hall of Famers, and the two I played with are still great friends of mine. So it was really, that was a no-brainer. And I kind of asked them both, hey, do you guys mind sitting on the stage? And, I mean, as a presenter, you don't really have to do anything. I mean, they would have come for me anyways. Now they just sit there behind me instead of in front of me. But super honored, obviously, that they both agreed to come. And I know they both have families and busy schedule in the summer, and so it means a lot that both are coming. I'm still super close with both, obviously. JK, I see all the time. With Steve, we travel now. We bring our families together all the time, and so both mean a lot to me, meant a lot to me during my career. So I'll be excited to see them and spend some time with them this weekend, and I'm just honored that they say yes.
Hey, Dirk, Cash Saroy, the Well Creative Productions. Obviously, you mentioned what fans mean to you, that you might not be able to mention this speech. You know what your speech is going to be like now. Knowing how emotional you got after winning the championship, what do you set the over-under at in number of times you lose it during your speech?
Good question. By the way, you made me look a fool for a lot of years being a clown on the Jumbotron, so thanks for that. I mean, I'm hoping that I won't get that much. You know, if I have sort of my script in mind, and you know, you want to kind of remind yourself, okay, what's next? Don't forget anybody. Like, I forgot my sister at Jersey retirement, of course. I mean, that's I can't let anything like that happen this weekend. And so we'll see. I mean, these things are sort of hard to plan with. And of course, my speech is sort of set, but I really don't want to stare at the teleprompter the entire night. I want to, some stuff will be spontaneous. Of course, I have sort of plan what I want to say to everybody, but some stuff will just come out and be spontaneous in the moment, and then I'm sure there'll also be some emotions involved. But overall, hopefully I can sort of stick to the plan and execute pretty well. But leading up, I watched a few inductions, of course, from my friends. I rewatched Steve and Jay Kidd, and I watched Timmy Duncan, and the first thing he goes up there says, man, I played a lot of game sevens, but I'm actually more nervous now than any game seven ever. And I sort of feel the same way. Obviously, I'm not huge in public speaking. I'm not huge in being in the limelight. So I feel the same way. I've been super nervous leading up to this now the last few weeks already. So I'm going to try to hold it together and hopefully just execute and really just, you know, express that I'm extremely grateful to everybody who's been involved in my career. Really, that's all I want.
Hi, Dirk, TamaraMavs.com. You know, I think when I look back at your career, one of the highlights a lot of people may not know is that you would get thousands and thousands of fan mail over and over, and you would sign every last one in the office. You'd be there late at night. Where did that passion for doing that come from?
Well, you know, the Mavs have always done a good job to from the beginning when I got here and say, you know, the community plays a big role in us being successful. The community supports us, and we need to take care of fans and the community. And so we've done community outreach events from the beginning, and that's how you sort of are raised into this league, that it means a lot for the fans to come out and support and so you need to learn at events, at fan mail, whatever the case may be, to pay that back and pay that respect back, that and the love and the support that you get from the fans. And so, yeah, I took fan mail serious. Always I try to make it to the office every couple of weeks. Sometimes, of course, it was harder than other times, but I always try to do fan mail and, you know, talk to Lisa in the office or people on the business side that I don't get to see much or interact much during the season. So I always enjoy my time.
Hi, Dirk. Reagan Elam here with 97.9 The Beat, the number one hip-hop station in DFW.
You already know.
Yes. Congratulations on such a remarkable, inspiring career. What would the Hall of Famer Dirk tell the rookie Dirk in times of being unsure of yourself and, you know, you just being here right now accepting this honor?
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, it was just what I was doing, and that's, you know, keep pushing. I think it's normal when things don't go well to have doubts, and especially I'm not the most, you know, positive guy. So in my first couple of years, of course, there were some doubts. Did I make the right decision? Should I have gone to college? Should I have stayed in Europe? But at the end of the day, just keep pushing, put your head down and really focus on what you can control. You can't control playing time and all that other stuff, but you can control how hard you work and the effort you put in. Do you come to practice early? Do you leave late? Are you really, you know, giving everything you got to this? And so that's what I would tell myself. Keep doing that. Keep your work ethic and work through the hard times. When you struggle, you go back to the gym and you try to find your way. And that's what I always try to do, and that's the only way really I knew how to get through tough times, and that would be my advice even now. And at the time, I didn't even know what I was doing. I was just, I got to make this work, and I go back to the gym, and now obviously that was my coping mechanism of just working hard and trying to make it work. Oh, thank you guys. Thank you, and good to see everybody. Hopefully we'll see you down the road. Appreciate it. Vouchers?